Hi, everyone. I'm Barbara Beck, and I want to thank you for tuning in to Welcome Home. Today's program is one we all need to hear and think about, and that's how are we doing balancing what's really important in our lives? Are we living life to the fullest with purpose and intentionality, or are we just going through the motions? Well, if we don't do a check every so often with ourselves, I really firmly believe that we will ultimately miss what's really important. And we're going to be discussing balance in life. How do we balance taking care of our families with, say, ministry or with work, exercise, our personal time with God? There's so much being thrown at each of us, and are we really taking time to prioritize the essential rather than just responding to the critical? Well, I'm super interested in seeing how the current ladies feel about this topic, because they're all in the throes of tending to husbands and small children, teenagers, careers, and ministry. And I want to know, how do you do it all, ladies? Because you're really doing a good job, but is it a hard job?
Well, thank you, Barbara. Because probably 99.9% of the time, we don't feel like we're doing a good job. But thank God for Jesus, is all I have to say. And thank God for His grace. And thank God that His mercies are new every morning, because there is no perfect balance. I want to liberate our viewers and say, there is no perfect balance. Be free from that. Don't look on Pinterest. Stop looking, Googling things, or, you know, looking at Instagram or watching other people's lives that look like they can do it all, have it all, be it all, because it does not exist. It's a picture. It's an image. It's not reality.
Well, that's from a free spirit's point of view. I have a daughter who is not such a free spirit, and she would say, yes, you can balance, because
30%. No, I wouldn't. I was thinking,
really?
I was thinking exactly what you're
saying. Thank you, God. Liberate us.
The balance is a misnomer. I don't think we have balance, and I don't think that we have to have the pressure to have balance.
So you don't do 30% with family, 30%. I mean, you're a CPA, for goodness sakes.
No. But I'm also a realist, and I recognize that's hard to do. Okay. And I just, whatever I'm doing at that moment, I want to do the best that I can. Okay. And I'm just going to let the other stuff go. Yesterday, for example, I was painting my daughter's room. And Luke, sweet Luke, I'm trying to get it done before she's out of town or she comes back home, but sweet Luke was in the other room watching TV, and I was conflicted. Do I go spend time with Luke, or do I finish this off? And then I was just you know what, I'm doing the best I can do. Well, Luke and I'll do something fun today.
Yep.
The room's going to get finished, and we can only do what we can do.
Well, the other CPA on the panel. Somebody's not 30%.
I am a little bit more spreadsheet. Okay, you know. Well, when I left my son at school one day, I realized, this was years ago, that he was so mad at me, and I just said, I'm sorry, and I'm so not perfect, and we just can't do it all. There is that misnomer, you just can't. But I've learned, the older I get, I've learned to say no. Mm-hmm. And I've learned to pull off my plate what is not the best for your best. Yes, I've been reading that book. Mm-hmm. And so really making sure that what God's gifted you with, you do those things, and what's right for your family. The other day I made plans with friends to go out to dinner. We all get together, and then we want to make the next plan. I don't know if y'all do that too.
We're always
When I'm at a party, I want to plan the next get together. And we were doing it, and I had planned it for the day my son was coming home from camp, and I texted my girls, and I was like, absolutely not. Good. Y'all have gone without me. Yeah. My son is coming home. We're going to go out for a family dinner. And so just the freedom, I think, to just say no, and just, it's not the right thing for my family.
It is so hard. I mean, I'm sitting here, you're talking about balance. I'm sitting here thinking, does anybody have it? Because I'm going to take notes today. Because I think it's what, and I mean, I'm not a CPA. I like how when she says CPA, she looks at you guys, and she looks away like, don't talk to Carolyn.
You're creative people.
Well, we are creative people. But you know, I think it's hard for people like us girls, because we are such driven women. I know there's a lot of women out there who are very driven. Mm-hmm. We're very, you know, I like getting up on my day. I call living it on purpose. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I am the type of woman, it's like, I got up yesterday. What did I tell you yesterday? I'm like, I really wanted to be studying and really be doing all this stuff. And I'm looking at my kids, and they're watching TV and playing computers going, I can't do that. Mm-hmm. You know, I've got to get out here and entertain these children and do something with them. So I'm like, get in the kitchen, let's cook today. And it was like cooking day. But it's hard. Mm-hmm. Something, you have to give up something in order to have something else. And I think it really comes back to all of us, what we're doing is prioritizing our lives and going, okay. Mm-hmm. And I was talking with a bunch of young girls about it this past week. I said, you know, the biggest thing I've learned to do in my own life is decide what I want it to look like in 5 years or in 10 years. Mm-hmm. And at the end of 5 years, I'd like for my children to like me, my husband to like me. And, you know, yes, and would I like important. To have a perfect clean house in the middle of it? Man. Oh, how I love a perfectly clean yes. house. But you all have really helped me with that to go, you know what? I would much rather at the end of it say, mm-hmm. I have the relationship like right. you guys yeah. have. Then maybe that yeah. they remember that my house was so perfect all
yeah,
the
because,
time.
Yeah, because, you know, we are very, and I think you really hit the nail on the head, Carolyn, mm-hmm. talking about type A dominant mm-hmm. personalities who really are task-oriented. I'm yeah. very task-oriented. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I want to get the job mm-hmm. done. But I also know in my head, might not be in my heart, but it's in my head, that the relationship is more important. You yeah. know, I even had that with my niece. You were talking about Luke and painting the room. I remember I was painting back when we had our little niece staying with us, and I thought, I put her in front of the TV while I was doing all this kind of painting. And that was, looking back on that, I remember that to this day, and that was probably 30 years ago, mm-hmm. that who cares about mm-hmm. the paint? You know, I could have been spending that time with that little girl.
I love right. how you said yeah. that. We have to take the mom guilt off of us.
You
and go,
do.
Yeah. There's things that's got to be done.
And it's holding it captive every moment. I think one thing yeah. that was so cool this summer was, you know, we were over at the beach and we just made a decision. We were going to travel somewhere far. We were going to go somewhere close and sit and just be and play mm-hmm. and have fun. That's one thing I love about Barbara. We call her our otter because yeah. she loves to play. And I think that's what keeps us young. And I literally sat down. Now, the old me would be like, oh, I'm going to get sand in my bathing suit. I'm going to walk away and it's not going to be good. And I literally sat there on my bottom and so did my husband. And we dug for 2.5 hours, the biggest hole almost to China. And we built this huge just dribble castle. And I just sat there and grabbed the water and it brought me back to being a child and being mm-hmm. present. Mm-hmm. I was there. I could smell the ocean air. I could see the sun, you know, going on my daughter's little face. And I could, you know, watch Kingston just being so thankful that we're present. And that's the best gift we can give ourselves. Mm-hmm. We can give our children, our husbands, and our friendship too. Right. It's being present. And that takes releasing all of these false expectations, all of these lies. And there's a movie out right now called Bad Mom, and I laugh so hard about it because I don't care, you know, what superstar Christian you are. We all have those moments we feel like we're a bad mom, but that's where God's grace steps in. I think we can learn to laugh at ourselves and keep it all into perspective and keep the main thing, then we can receive joy. We can receive peace. We can be present for those moments because someone really wise told me this in ministry. She's a woman that I look up to. You know, she's traveled all over the world, has a very successful ministry. But guess what? She told me, she looked at me, she goes, Courtney, and this is when I was Mrs. Florida, she goes, you're never going to get this time back. She goes, that was the number one regret I had was I conquered mm-hmm. and did all this in ministry. But all of a sudden I look and here's my son graduating from high school. Yeah. And mm-hmm. I don't want to miss that. And so I don't want to trade family, marriage, anything for accomplishments because mm-hmm. the biggest accomplishment is being present.
Well, let's throw the word purpose in there. What is, you said let the main thing be the main thing. Yeah. The main thing is what is our purpose in life? And what is your purpose in life, ladies? Why are we put here on this planet?
We talk to our kids all the time and it's just short because they're young, but we really believe that our kids, we say kings are kind mm-hmm. and kings love Jesus and serve others. And I hope that sticks with them because yeah. I really want them to know ultimately at our core is kindness. Mm-hmm. And how does that make other people feel and how are we serving them? Mm-hmm. And I think one of the things that sometimes we can forget is when we are busy, mm-hmm. We get wrapped up in it, but to focus on who we're serving mm-hmm. as opposed to kind of the other distractions or how we appear or how we look mm-hmm. or, but to focus, to take the focus completely off of us mm-hmm. and just to focus on those that we're serving.
You know, I heard Andy Stanley I love listening to him preach, mm-hmm. and he did a sermon the other week about just on balancing our life and all this, and he was talking about he loves music. He loves to create, and he said that he built a room in his house. They were moving into a new house and putting a music room in, and all of a sudden he heard all of his kids downstairs, mm-hmm. and he said he heard the Holy Spirit for him mm-hmm. say, put it all away. Mm-hmm. Because he said at the end of it, and it really changed my life, that in the scripture I love is Ecclesiastes 3:1-8, for everything there is a season mm-hmm. and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born, a time to die. They can look it up. The whole point is sometimes it's us women who are driven and we have to realize there is a season for things. Sometimes yeah. there's a season that I just need to be a mom.
Yeah.
I need absolutely. To be there for my kids. There's a time that there's a season I need to be there for my husband. Mm-hmm. There's a season to be there for my friends. I need to be walking in that spirit that I'm sensitive to it, that I go, you need me today. Mm-hmm. My daughter needs me today. And I feel like that's what happens when I get alone with Christ, is I'm like, mm-hmm. Lord, today let me be in tune to you, to not only hear your spirit, but to hear mm-hmm. how I can be a servant of others. Because the Bible says the greatest amongst you mm-hmm. is the servant right. of all. Yeah. What a fresh look at life.
And what do we remember, you know, about our own childhoods? Mm-hmm. I remember times when my mother played with me, yeah. when my dad had me on his yeah. shoulder, you know, taking me out of a movie theater. And, you know, those are the silly times that we really remember. Just recently, there was a post on Instagram that just blew up because it was so precious. It was Andy Searles. Andy is a great friend of ours here at Good Life 45. He's a pastor, and he was rocking out to a song, to a praise song, with his daughter in the car, like karaoke cab. And yeah. they were acting silly, and they were just singing at the top of their lungs. I'm telling you, that little girl is going to remember mm. her dad doing that more than she's mm. going to remember her dad sitting right. down with her and, you know, instructing her on how to do something or admonishing her or whatever. She's going to remember her dad as this fun-loving, great guy who did karaoke singing praise songs to Jesus in the car. It was mm-hmm. so precious. Did anybody see it?
It was awesome.
It blew up, didn't it? Everybody that's the best thing I've ever seen on Instagram.
It's hilarious. Yeah. And I think our kids need to see us laughing more and take the yep. pressure off. I mean, right now my husband is coaching my son in football, and they have to actually go through a 5-hour class in order to coach these kids. And one of the biggest things was take the pressure off these kids to perform. Tom Brady is an NFL quarterback, you know, Super Bowl champion many times over. He said, you know, one of the best things my parents did for me is at a young age, they didn't put the football in my hand and say, this is what you're going to do, this is how you're going to do it. They let me play. They let me go out and sit in the dirt or, you know, be bored a little bit. You know, it wasn't about the next activity, the next thing. You got to accomplish this. You got to do this at a young age. Because what happens is they burn out, and the parents burn out too. So it's about having fun, and the joy of the Lord is our strength, and that's what our kids need to see.
Okay, so you're telling me that you guys are having a hard time balancing. I don't think you have a hard time at all.
I think you all have
it. It's spirit-led balance.
I love it. I love it. Thanks so much for sharing all of your insights. And I think it helps and encourages me and encourages all of us to just hear each other say it over and over again. Enjoy life one day at a time. Enjoy your kids, your grandkids, relationships over tasks, right?
Amen.
It's possible to balance. Well, we've got more good stuff coming up on Welcome Home, so stay with us, viewers. Hi, everyone. I hope you are feeling fabulous and faithful, because if you're not, you will be. When we get finished with talking to Dr. Keita Joy Dutant, she's going to make you feel so special about yourselves. She has this wonderful book called Fabulous and Faithful. It's for women who want to love God, look good, and take over the world. And I guess that would be all of us. Dr. Keita Joy, thank you so much for being here with us today.
Thank you for having me. I'm excited.
Well, you've been here with us before on the
panel. I have.
Panel,
I feel like family
right?
a little
you
bit.
You are family.
You know?
You are a part of us. Thank you. Thank you so much. Tell us, before we start talking about how to be fabulous and faithful, you have a family and a wonderful husband. Tell us about that. I do.
Actually, coming up soon, my husband and I, we're going to celebrate 9 years being married.
Congratulations.
So we've been together for 12, but 9 years being married, and that's truly a blessing, like, to be married to your best friend.
That's right.
Yeah.
And you have two little children.
I do.
Good.
My son, Maxwell, he's 5.
Oh, I love that.
Which means he's going to kindergarten.
Yes.
So we're, like, gearing up. I'm, like, emotionally preparing for that. And then I have our daughter, Michaela, and she's 3. So we're busy.
You are. Yes. You are busy. What a precious little family that you have. Well, what made you want to write this book to begin with, Keita?
Honestly, I'm really big on listening to God, mm-hmm. being obedient to Him, and it really just started with my testimony. Okay. I feel like for so many years, I settled a lot in my relationship with God. Hmm. I grew up as an only child. My dad and my mom, they were divorced, but my dad was really present in my life.
Good.
And so
you were blessed.
Yes, very, mm-hmm. very blessed. But he passed away when I was 12. Mm. And when he passed away, it was almost like a piece of me yeah. went away as well. And so my self-esteem dropped. Mm. Just my outlook on life, it completely changed. Mm-hmm. And I really had a hard time understanding my worth, that I was made for more, that I was made in God's image. It was just hard for me to understand that. So once I had a relationship with God at the age of 19, I was starting to learn that. But you know, God talks about how you have to renew your mind. So it's a process.
Yes,
it's not
it
like
is.
I have this relationship with God and then right away I just right. knew my
right.
all of my
well,
worth.
Well, we're still growing and it's yeah. still a big, big journey. And I love that you say that about your dad, because Key to Joy, I have always said I had a wonderful, loving, godly father in
yes.
my life. And I've always said it's easy to be a mom and
yes.
to be nurturing and loving, and people who have great moms, that's wonderful, what a blessing, but to have a godly dad in
yes.
your life and somebody who really pours into you makes a big difference.
It does.
And so you lost your dad at a really, really young age.
I did.
But God restored that. He restored what the locusts had eaten right
yes.
in your life.
Yes.
So now you're wanting to help other women in particular
yes.
learn to be fabulous and faithful.
Yes. And to not, so what that means is to be a woman where you refuse to settle,
mm.
where you know that God made you for more and you deserve to have more through God.
Yes.
And it's okay. Like, you're worth it.
Right.
There's no disclaimer.
Yeah.
Like, once you have a relationship with Jesus, you are worth so much, and God wants to use you to do amazing things. So this is about just women really unleashing their very, very best mm-hmm. for themselves, for their family, and for God.
Well, you know, Key to Joy, what we talked about on the current panel was how to do some of what you're talking
okay.
about. And sometimes we as women, particularly really gung-ho women like you, type A personalities who
yes.
accomplish a lot, are brilliant or beautiful and all that, it's hard to balance it all. How do you balance family and ministry and your work and your everything that you do? How do you do this balancing act?
Good question.
Difficult,
yes.
right?
Honestly, it takes being transparent mm-hmm. and being vulnerable and knowing when to ask for help.
Good.
For many
good.
Years, I thought I had to be this superwoman
right.
and handle everything on my own. And that was a big fat lie.
Mm.
It's like, no, I'm stronger when I'm surrounded by other people who are supporting me, who are there for me.
Like who? Who are some of the people who support you?
Well, number one, my husband.
Okay.
So he's locked in for life.
Okay, good. I love
so
that.
He doesn't really have a choice, though, but he, you know, he loves supporting my
yes.
business. He's such a great father. And so basically what that looks like is there's some days I'm not able to cook because of my schedule.
Mm-hmm.
So he'll fill in
mm-hmm.
and he'll prepare food certain days. And so that
good.
I don't have to, just
right.
to kind of
right.
compensate and help each other out. You know, he takes care of certain things in the
mm-hmm.
house. I take care of certain things in the home. My mom helps a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this is a whole village.
Yeah. And
you know,
friends. You
friends
have friends who help
out.
Okay.
Even now, while we speak, I have a babysitter
yes.
at the house right now,
right.
someone we really trust who's
yeah.
with the kids. So
mm-hmm.
it takes a village,
sure.
but it first takes you opening up and saying
that
you need
help.
Help.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, you call yourself, you talk about a business, your business is that of a life coach,
yes.
a success coach,
yes.
you're a motivational speaker as
yes.
well.
Yes, and now author.
And now author.
Yeah.
You are a high achiever. I really don't know how you do it all with a young, young family, a 3-year-old and a 5-year-old. And
I know.
I mean, it is just tough, right?
Yeah, I really make sure I take time for myself.
How do you do that?
So even if I have to get up earlier before everybody in the house gets
yeah.
up, I have to take time to meditate
okay.
and I take time to pray
mm-hmm.
and read God's word
okay.
before I talk to anybody else. So that's like my coffee before the coffee.
Right, right.
Because I still love Starbucks, but
yes.
before I even hit that, the true coffee, getting
yeah.
revved up for the day, is like going to God by
You're
myself.
Wise. Very wise
yeah.
woman. That's
yeah.
good. That grounds you. That gives you, it helps you understand. For me, it does.
Yeah.
Helps me remember what's really important
yes.
in keeping the main thing,
exactly.
which is Jesus Christ in our lives.
Right.
But I love what you've done with your book. I want you to
Thank
walk
you.
Us through what you do with each day. It's 31 days. It's a devotional.
Yes.
If women
women want to have a devotional that's really going to be practical, what you've done here is to give us some serious steps of application to help us to grow. Tell us what each day looks like.
Okay, well, the way I did it, I say it's made for the successful woman because a lot of times in this society, you're on the go. Mm-hmm. We're moving fast.
Right.
And I didn't want women to feel guilty that they didn't have this whole hour every single day to worship God. Mm-hmm. But I wanted to make sure that you were still getting that meat and potatoes and connecting to Jesus. So it's quick. Mm-hmm. It's something that you can read before you go to work, before you pick up your kids from school. I know sitting in the car sometimes before you're going to get your kids from daycare, whatever it is, you can read it. And so each day has a quote, a powerful quote that kind of jump starts your day or gets you going throughout the day. I'm very transparent. I talk about struggles I've had in my life, insecurities, doubts, fears that I've dealt with. And I think that's important because a lot of times women, we can judge and compare ourselves to other women.
Sure.
And we can think, oh, well, she's got it all together.
Right.
So I make sure I help everyone to understand, no, we're all the same. Mm-hmm. We all have different struggles. Mm-hmm. But then I help you, how do you overcome those struggles? And not just overcome them, how can you be victorious?
Right.
And so victorious means whether you're a CEO, whether you're a school teacher, an attorney, a stay-at-home mom, how can you be successful with whatever God has given you.
Right, right. And you also have scripture at the end.
Oh,
so
yeah.
That's, to me, the most important part, to meditate on the scripture.
Yep.
And so I would say each devotional each day might take 5 to 7 minutes, something like that.
Yeah.
Not any more than that.
Yeah, I would, the most 10 minutes of your time.
A day.
Yep,
right.
But those 10 minutes are going to be so powerful and it'll stick with you for the whole day. And so each day also has questions.
I like that.
Yeah.
And then a faith step that you tell people, okay, then do something with this. Share it with a friend.
Right.
Go out and make a difference. Serve somebody. Take a meal to somebody.
I don't want you just to feel good and warm and fuzzy. God is about, faith is about action.
Exactly.
Now, what are you going to do?
Right, Key to Joy, what do you mean when you say marry your purpose in life? How do you marry your purpose? What does that mean?
The first thing is you have to identify it.
Okay.
Right?
What is your purpose, by the way?
My purpose is to encourage and empower as many women as possible.
Good.
And so the way God has done that, I've been a teacher before. Mm-hmm. I was a school counselor before. And
now
I'm able to do that through coaching and speaking and writing. Okay. But the purpose still remains the same.
Sure.
I love encouraging and empowering people to be their best. Mm-hmm. That's where I thrive.
So you identify your purpose and then what?
And then once you identify it, now you have to cultivate it.
Okay.
You have to nurture it, just like in a marriage. I love my husband, but we need to be praying together. Sometimes we need to have counseling. We need to be learning new ways that we can love each other. Mm-hmm. So it's continually growing in your marriage. So it's also growing in your purpose. Mm-hmm. Just knowing it is not enough.
Right.
Now you've got to cultivate it.
Good.
Are you reading things? Are you connecting with others who are going to help you launch your purpose and live it out.
Right, because when you're married, you really do. I always say this, I'm working all the time to make my marriage better, to save my marriage.
Yes.
I have to work with it, just like with your purpose. I love that. Marry your purpose. What do we do as women, Key to Joy, that sometimes we settle for mediocrity? You address that in your book.
Oh, yeah. And I address it because I went through it. And sometimes I still go through it when God's taking me to the next level. Mm-hmm. A lot of times I'll ask these questions to God, why me?
Mm-hmm.
You know, or are you sure you picked me?
Yeah.
Maybe. Did you make a mistake? Did you mean to pick someone else? And God's like, no, I chose you.
Mm-hmm.
You're my treasured possession.
Mm-hmm.
You're an heir now.
Yeah.
And so it's constantly remembering who I am in Christ. And God talks about in Ephesians 3:20, we can do immeasurably more.
Yeah.
You know, he can do that through us.
Right.
You know, immeasurably more than we can even ask or imagine.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like constantly remembering that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
What do you see, Key to Joy, for your life in the future? Because you are such a huge, huge, big achiever.
Yes.
What is your vision for your life?
Honestly, in the simplest terms, I just want God to continue putting me on a platform where I can just talk to women, encourage women to be their very best.
Mm-hmm.
That's my heart's desire.
Mm-hmm.
That's really what I love to do. That's what it's all about. It's like, how many women, God, can I reach? Because isn't that what it's about?
Yes.
It's like whatever he's giving you, I just want to pour it out.
Right.
So it's like, God, show me all the women that I can speak to and teach and encouraged to love you and to use their gifts to help someone else. Because that's what
that.
It's about. It's
I love
like
that.
Each one teach one.
Yes.
Now that I'm able to
right.
teach you, now you go out and you teach somebody else.
Right.
Let's continue spreading the love of God to yeah. as many women as possible.
I love that. Well, why are we so fearful as women? That's something I've noticed in all of my years, is that oftentimes people say, I can't do that. I'm yeah. not good enough. Or that's a job for a man, and there's a glass ceiling, and how do I crash through that glass ceiling? Why? What is it? Why is it that fear oftentimes paralyzes and cripples us, Key to Joy, as women?
One, we allow it to. I think a lot of times we think that we're not supposed to feel fear. But
yeah.
we're humans.
Yeah, we are fearful.
We're fearful.
We are.
You look in the Bible,
yeah.
that's how, why God always said, remember, remember.
Yes.
I'm always
yes.
with you. Take heart. Mm-hmm. Have courage. Because it's not even just a woman thing. Men and women, we go through that same struggle yeah. where we fear.
Yeah.
And because we're constantly thinking we're inadequate mm-hmm. and we're not good enough. Mm-hmm. So what I always have to do is I have to take those feelings and then I line it up with the Word of God.
Uh-huh.
And if there's an inconsistency, then I'm like, okay, God, even though I feel this way, I'm going to ask. Act on what you say.
Mm.
So,
mm-hmm.
you know, there's a quote that says you feel the fear and you just do it
yes,
anyway.
Anyway.
You
right.
just get out there and you just do it. And what I mm-hmm. noticed, the more and more I just act in faith, my faith grows.
That's great.
And my fear decreases.
That's right.
So, but I always tell women, you're going to have fear.
Yeah.
A lot of times we think, oh, these successful women don't have fear. No, they have it. They
mm-hmm.
just know it's a lie.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
That's
all. Right. It's from the enemy.
Exactly.
It really is. Especially
exactly.
if it keeps us from doing what we know God wants us to do.
Exactly.
And what calls, God calls us to do things oftentimes that are out of our comfort zone.
All
I mean,
the
you
time.
Were not born as a baby, as a 2-year-old, 4-year-old. One day I'm going to be a motivational speaker and I'm going to be a life coach. I'm going to teach people how to be successful in life. I didn't come out of the womb saying, I want to be a talk show host one day on a Christian stick.
Right.
God just calls us to these things, and it's
yes.
not always what we've been trained to do and not always our dream to do.
Right.
But that's what we need to do, is to listen to God's voice.
And I know T.D. Jakes talked about this before. I always listen to his sermons, how God will leave these clues,
mm.
these clues to your destiny. Because I was
mm-hmm.
the only child, and I was
yeah.
always like a blabbermouth. I talked to anybody who would let you want to listen.
That's
I'll
shocking.
Talk to you.
I can't believe that.
I know, right? But just to see how God, he'll prepare you for
yes.
your purpose.
Right.
He
absolutely.
Really will prepare you, and he'll leave these clues along the way. You
yes.
just have to have that faith to step out.
There are ladies listening today and
yes.
men out there who
That's
listen.
Right.
What kind of advice, because we're just about out of time, but if you could have one thing that you would say to a viewer out there listening today to have a more victorious life in Christ, what would you tell that person?
Well, I want to tell all of you really just to be fabulous and faithful. And it's pretty much, it's a 3-step model to make sure that you're loving God first, looking good from the inside out, and then take over the world. Go after your dreams and go after your goals.
All right, you got to do the motions because you taught me the motions ahead of time. Let's
yes,
do it.
You ready, Barbara?
Love God.
Love God.
Love God.
Look good.
Look good.
And take over the world.
Take over the world.
You did good. It was good.
Dr. Keita Joy Dutton, thank you so much for
Thank
being
you
here
for
with
having
us today.
Me.
You're a joy and an inspiration.
Thank
you. If you want more information on
yes.
Dr. Keita Joy's book, you can go to her website, which is on the screen for you now. Again, fabulous and faithful,
yes.
Dr. Keita Joy. Stay with us. We have more coming up.
glad that you joined us today here on Welcome Home. We have a very special guest who is the CEO of Andrew Womack's Ministries there in Colorado Springs. And Paul Milligan, thank you so much for being here with us today.
Thank you.
It's a thrill to have you. And you know we love our Andrew Womack. He gets more wonderful, positive comments from people. And I know that a lot of our viewers might know this. Some of you may not realize that we have Charis Bible College right here at Good Life 45 as a part of our ministry, really, because we support it and think so much of what you all are doing. You want to tell us a little bit, Paul, about what Charis Bible College is?
Yes. Charis Bible College is a big part of Andrew's vision. Basically, Andrew's vision is to reach as far and as deep with the gospel as possible in his lifetime. That's what God spoke to him. And Charis represents the deep part of that vision. Far denotes bringing people into the kingdom and salvation, and discipleship is what Charis is about. So we have a two-year college. The college system now is over 70 locations worldwide.
That's great.
Over 6,000 students.
Wow.
And the college in Colorado will have about 1,000 students this September when school starts. So we have a two-year college there, and then we have three-year programs. We have 8 three-year programs, and I direct the business college, which is one of those three-year programs.
And that's part of the reason why you're here. Yeah, I know you live in Colorado Springs, but you're here to tell us about a summit that's getting ready to happen in October.
Yes, we started last year doing what we call Charis Business Summits. And a couple of my main instructors in the business college, who are very accomplished men, Dr. Dean Radke, who was leadership team with Avon Corporation and with the Limited. And God has basically given Dr. Radke a scriptural system for how to grow and manage big organizations. You can, from starting as an entrepreneur through a big corporation. And then Billy Epperhart, who is a real estate developer, millionaire from the real estate business, a good friend of mine for 30 years. And Billy not only teaches real estate, but he's just a genius at organizational management. Mm-hmm. And then I'll be doing teaching as well. And I have over 35 years experience building companies. Mm-hmm. So we're going to have a summit that is going to be designed for business leaders, even entrepreneurs, executives, sort of what we're calling an elite or kind of an advanced in some areas. We've done entrepreneurial kind of business summits, but this one we're going to teach people, how do you grow a business? How do you get it to grow? How do you build leadership down into your organization? You know, as we say, when you run out of leaders, you run out of gas.
Yeah.
And so how do you develop leaders? How do you do it down in your organization? And then some very practical things I'm going to be teaching on what every business owner should understand about finances in their business. And Dr. Radke is going to teach how to build what he calls a highly torqued organization. But basically what he means by that is a company that is on the grow and consistently growing and developing. So we're looking forward. It's going to be an elite. We've actually got people can go to charissummit.com and register there, and we've got an elite registration, a VIP registration.
Good.
That's going to be very interesting if people are interested in doing that.
Wonderful.
They'll
yeah.
get to spend private time with us.
Okay.
With that VIP registration and
right.
some things like that.
So, Paul, tell me how you, as a very successful businessman, and I would call you an entrepreneur as well, how did you go from, and was it a difficult transition to go from being an entrepreneur / businessman to being CEO of a major, huge ministry in Colorado Springs? Big transition?
Parts of it were a challenge, major transition, but I've been associated with Andrew for so many years on the board of directors that I knew a great deal about the ministry. And then the rest of it is just what I learned in business, how to grow an organization, how to manage it. And so that part of it wasn't as big a transition as just the learning curve. You know, Andrew has a big television ministry. Sure. I knew nothing about television, so I had to learn all of that. And so it's been a challenge, but we've had a good time doing it, and the ministry's continuing to grow.
Absolutely.
Dramatically.
Absolutely. So tell me, Paul, how you have the faith component in business, which I'm sure you probably did, even though it was a two secular businesses that you had. Did your faith and did the faith of those around you in leadership have anything to do, do you think, with the success of your businesses?
Oh, yes, ma'am. You know, whether any business people want to admit it or not, they get to the end of their ability and what they know.
Yeah. Right.
And, you know, I just believe, Barbara, that if we're not stretched And if we're not exercising our faith, then we're not probably doing what God's called us to do, or at least not reaching our potential. Mm-hmm. Faith is very important, and I like to stay challenged in that sense. And it's certainly a challenge with Andrew. He puts his faith out there.
Sure.
But we did this in business. I could give you situation after situation where we just believed God and he came through because there was no other way for us to do it. Mm-hmm. Have had some pretty significant crisis in business, as most have, and God saw us through those by faith.
Mm-hmm. So what kind of advice would you give to maybe a young entrepreneur out there today who's listening, or someone who's just out of school and they're trying to start their own business and really are seeking God's path for them, maybe not in the ministry world, but maybe in a secular world, which is the path that you chose for many years? What kind of advice would you give that person?
Well, first of all, I think Christians need to understand that they're called to business. Mm-hmm. You know, when Jesus came to start his ministry and it came time to choose his disciples, you know, I probably would have gone to the synagogue looking for my disciples. Hmm. He went to the marketplace.
No, that's true. That's a good point.
And so what we teach our students is that this is a calling. Thank God for the fivefold ministry. But business leaders are called to create wealth for the kingdom of God. And there's an army of us out there. Most of us don't even know it. Mm-hmm. And so we encourage that with an entrepreneur. The other thing is that in business, it's not what you know that's going to determine your success or failure. It's what you don't know. Hmm. It's the things you don't know that sneak up on you and get you in business. And so preparation is extremely important. Mm-hmm. And that's why we believe in the third-year program at Caris Bible College for business. And we have some stellar examples and testimonies of people who've come out of the business school. So you got to prepare. You got to know your industry. You got to know the business. And so preparation time is never wasted time in that sense.
And wouldn't you say priorities have a lot to do with it? We've been talking today on the program about balancing family with work, with ministry, with your personal time, with even recreation. Having a great balance, but also putting into perspective, what's the most important thing? Keeping the main thing the main thing.
Yes, ma'am. And, this is what we teach. This has been just freeing for so many people. Everything we teach in the business college is a scriptural basis. Believe it or not, most people wouldn't know this, especially outside the kingdom.
Sure.
But God has taught us in the Word how to build businesses, how to build big organizations. And God wouldn't do that unless it included a quality of life and a relationship with Him.
Yes.
And this is why formulas don't work. Because formulas in the Word of God have never worked for me, because God won't bypass a relationship with people to make formulas work for you.
Yeah.
And so what we talk about is that quality of life has to do with doing it God's way.
Yeah.
And most people in our culture think of business as you got to work 90 hours a week and you got to sacrifice your family on the altar of your business. It's just not true.
I love hearing that from you, because you've been very successful, but you didn't feel like you had to sacrifice family.
We didn't. We raised our children in the church. They're all serving God.
Praise God.
And God has blessed us so much in that sense. And, you know, it's hard work to build a business, but you don't have to sacrifice. God doesn't make you sacrifice anything. Mm-hmm. And so we've learned how to teach our students how to have a quality of life while they're building their business.
Well, I know that you came to talk about the summit. That's a part of the reason that you're here today. But honestly, Paul, that message is so important for our viewers to hear today, for me to hear today. You know, we never need to sacrifice relationships over that achieving kind of, I mean, if you're an entrepreneur, you're somebody who is a type A personality. You want to achieve. You have a task. You have a to-do list. And yet you know in your heart that relationships are more important than all of the others.
My mother used to say that people are the only thing that matter in life. Oh. Everything else is window dressing.
I love that.
And so we adopted that in our business.
Mm-hmm.
You know, one of my values that we publish in Global Technical Service, the company that we built, is that we value people over profit. And a lot of people don't understand what that means. You still have to, have profit to be successful.
Sure.
But there's a trade-off there, and you have to teach people how to develop their own personal lives, how to have time for their families, have time with God. Mm-hmm. And the whole time we were building our companies, we watched that. I had young men with young families, and I helped them guard that in their relationships with God, and it built a successful organization.
Well, and part of the reason it was successful, I think, Paul, I don't know that much about you, but I would think that God honored that incredible work ethic in you and that desire to see family over profit.
People over profit. That is wonderful. Let me just ask you one more question because we're about out of time. But you've been a Christian, Paul, for a long time.
Yes, ma'am.
Love the Lord. We love Andrew Womack and all the ministry things that he does here in Central Florida and around the world. What is your purpose in life? You, Paul Milligan.
That's interesting. I wish I had time to really tell you the whole story, but let me give you the cliff notes. In 1998, I had pretty much made it clear that I was to be in business and built these businesses, and I had prophecies from the 70s on through. So we knew we were doing what God called us to do. But in 1998, we went through a process of taking the company public so that I could get my other investors out mm-hmm. and get their money out. That didn't work out, and I don't have time to go into that story, but I say that to say this. When I left New York, we were actually about to go public on Wall Street the next morning. Mm. When I left New York, I stayed several days. My wife and my executives and their wives went on home. And when I was in the airplane flying back to Texas, I was just praying. I said, God, I don't have a vision past this. Mm. What have you called me to do? Yeah. And the Lord spoke to me during that time and said, I've called you to teach, train, mentor, and disciple the next generation of business leaders. That was just so peaceful. And I said, okay, I can do this.
Yeah.
And that's how we ended up at Andrews doing mm-hmm. the business college. I started mm-hmm. the business college 5 years ago.
Right.
So we're doing exactly what God told us. We're teaching, we're training, we're mentoring, and discipling a generation of business leaders that are going to do it God's way with God's scriptural system.
Right. Paul Milligan, you are a rock star. I so appreciate you and your heart, how you love the Lord, teaching, training, and mentoring the next generation for Disciples for Christ. So thank you so much for being here with us today. October 12th through 14th is the Caris Business Summit that's going to be held here in Orlando. You'll hear more about that, and we'll have some of that information up on the screen for you to look that up if you are interested in that. So again, thank you so much, Paul, for being here with us.
Thank you, Barbara.
Stay with us. We've got more good stuff coming up.
Welcome to Graceful Living. This is Dr. Faith Frederick from Faith Christian University. It is my joy to be with the Good Life TV 45 family. And one of the passions of my life is to bring a clearer and accurate interpretation of grace, because that's what transformed me and my life. I love to quote Martin Luther when he said, if we are unaware of the true meaning of grace, there will simply be no way that we will be able to comprehend the magnitude or awesomeness of grace. You know, we've talked about the Apostle Paul, and you may be familiar, you may not be so familiar with this story, but he received a revelation of grace that caused him to endure terrible persecution, imprisonment, and every difficulty that he went through. I've spoken about how God gives special grace for every season of our life. I've written a book called Grace Like Rain, and it tells my story about after many years of life and ministry, my life was turned upside down, and then God turned it right side up. That's when I found that I just believe that there is a grace that is more than enough. That's one of the things that God teaches in His Word. So therefore, with this fresh revelation, I just so enjoyed teaching at Faith Christian University, a school that I founded in 1995. And I love to teach on the book of Acts. And following Jesus' resurrection, this story is so adaptable to what you're going through today. And then after Jesus was resurrected, he returned and spent 40 days teaching and training the disciples and other believers. And his training was to take the gospel to the world. And then he gave them instructions. And these instructions were very precise. And that was to go back to Jerusalem. And there's a room there. And they're to wait until they're endued or receive the power of the Holy Spirit. See, the book of Acts tells us that when the Holy Spirit was manifested, was poured out, then Peter preached and 3,000 people were saved. They also witnessed miracles, power, joy, and great boldness. But Let's go on to Acts 4:33, and the Apostle Luke gives witness to another manifestation of the Holy Spirit, but we don't hear a lot about it. See, with great power, the apostles gave witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and it says, and great grace was upon them all. Now, what is this phenomenon? How did they do this? While most people, here's the deal, while most people would run away from persecution and hard times, we find these Spirit-filled believers, they ran toward imminent danger, and grace was always there in full manifestation. Friends, as persecution spread, imprisonment was at their heels, grace was accelerated, and this continued. I want to speak to all that are fulfilling the call of God in your life. You're in ministry, and maybe things are kind of difficult, but if we follow Paul's example, he states in Galatians 1:15, but when it pleased God who separated me from my mother's womb and called me through His grace. Listen closely. Paul attributes his calling to one thing, and that thing is grace. See, our calling doesn't say anything about us, but it says everything about the one who called us. Paul gives all the credit to God when he states emphatically in 1 Corinthians 15:10, but by the grace of God, I am what I am, and His grace toward me was not in vain, but I labored more, abundantly more than all. Yet not I, but the grace of God which was in me. See, Paul makes it very clear that everything he was and everything he accomplished was because of grace. Paul said, no education did this, no position did this, nothing else put me where I am, but by the grace of God. See, true grace operating and manifesting in and through our lives is mandatory for a truly successful life in ministry. And the only way to access the abundance of grace is by faith. Now, as the New Testament church begins to take shape, the Apostle Paul is now speaking to the Corinthian church, and he says this, I love this. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you having all sufficiency in all things may have an abundance for every good work. See, it doesn't just say continue. It doesn't just say a little bit. It says abound, have enough and more to spare, increase over and above, in excess, have more and have abundance. I know there's been times probably in your life, I know there has been in my life in ministry, when I was faced with overwhelming challenges. But every time I came to a place that I had to decide, am I going to allow this by indulging my emotions and going into self-pity to consume me? Or am I going to agree with God and go with abounding grace? See, there's two major things that keep us from having more than enough. The first is unbelief. Okay, just say it. Lord, face your unbelief. Help me. Help thou my unbelief. The second reason might come as a surprise, but I believe that pride is a great hindrance. But I believe that pride also is really a byproduct of unbelief. Because James 4:6 says that God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. One of the hardest things for us to do is to lay down our agenda and let God be God. Even in those times that you feel out of control and the most vulnerable, I believe the Holy Spirit is saying to you, if you will lay it down, I will pick you up. Let's go over 2 Corinthians 9:8 so we really get it clear. I love the Amplified Bible. Read with me, and God is able. God is able to make all grace, what is that? Every favor and earthly blessing, come to you in abundance so that you may always and under all circumstances and whatever the need be, self-sufficient, possessing enough to require no aid, no support, no welfare, and furnished in abundance for every good work and charitable donation. Wow, that's in the book. Here's what I do. I begin to profess and lay claim, make it mine, that every favor and earthly blessing is coming to me in abundance, and I will always, no matter the circumstances, I will have more than enough to do everything that God leads me to do. Friends, let's remember, God does not have a closed hand toward us. Neither does He have a clenched fist. He's not angry. He's not stingy. God is generous, and grace is the generosity of God. One of my favorites is Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7 and 8. It says, in Him, we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to what? The riches of His grace, which He made to abound toward us in all wisdom and prudence. Listen closely. God has provided through His Son redemption, forgiveness, peace, joy, prosperity. His generosity is in abundance. And the Bible says His grace is abounding toward us. Someone has said it's chasing us down. As long as we fight our own battles, unbelief and pride will be rampant. I found that to be true. But when we run up that white flag and we surrender, that's when God takes over and grace will abound. I truly believe grace is the greatest need in the church today. Grace for the unbeliever, grace for the broken, grace for the forgotten, grace for the lonely, because it's our greatest tool for evangelism. As we truly begin to love and accept one another in the gifting and calling that God has given each of us, and we begin to be stewards and partakers together of that grace, then we will shake this world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's been my privilege to be with you today, and I pray that you will begin your journey of grace, a journey that will bring anointing, power and divine enablement to be all and to do all that God has called you to be and to do. Friends, if you desire more teaching and training in the Bible and in the ministry, just call our school, Faith Christian University, and ask for a free packet, or go to our website and find out all about one of the most exciting and relevant Bible college programs around. It's very flexible, very affordable. Guess what? It's for everybody, all ages. God bless you, and I trust you will step forth by faith into all the grace that you need.
Well, I hope our program today encouraged each of us in our walk with the Lord, inspired us to be even more purposeful, more intentional to prioritize our lives, taking care, first of all, of our spiritual well-being, and that means reading the Bible, spending time in prayer, and fellowshipping with other Christians, and then ministering to our families, our spouses, children, grandchildren, and friends, but also taking time to care for our physical bodies, exercising, eating right, even playing and having fun, which I love to do. Those people who are closest to me know that I call myself an otter because I love to play, and I think that's a good thing. Now, if I only played all day, that would be imbalanced. Today's show was really one to get us to take a look at our lives and uncover ways to be more disciplined and obedient in our walk with the Lord. For me, it's probably spending more time in God's Word. That's an area that I always need more work on. For others, it might mean spending more time praying or serving others or even working hard. Just be prayerful about how we can be as effective as possible in this brief time that we have on this planet. And that's our note of hope for today. God bless you, and thanks so much for watching. Welcome home.